Spider-Man No Way Home is finally here, and now that I've seen the film three times, I can truly say this may be one of the best outings for Peter Parker of all time. Let's talk about it. It took me a little while to put this video together because this was a really highly anticipated movie for me. Ever since Far From Home came out and they had that great post-credit stinger,
Spider-Man's name is Peter Parker.
I've been waiting and waiting. And I've been talking about this movie for over a year. So when it played, and as many things happened as happened in this movie, it took me a minute to process that. But now that I've seen the movie three times, I think I finally kind of know where I stand. Before we jump into things, I do want to say there are some major, major surprises in this movie. If you still haven't seen it, know that I will not spoil anything in the first half of this video, but you can't talk about this movie without spoiling something. So the second half of this video will be entirely dedicated to spoilers. I will mark when you should click off. The first thing I want to say about Spider-Man No Way Home is that whether this is the best or worst Spider-Man movie is up for debate, but this is the most definitively accurate version of Peter Parker we've ever seen on screen. When you talk about that original comic book run, there has never been a movie that captures the spirit of that whole thing. It's a unique character and we've never seen it on film, but this is as close as it's ever gonna get. This is a different Peter than we've seen in both Far From Home and Homecoming. It simultaneously improves on the older movies and satisfies the Spider-Man fan in me who's always wanted to see what the comic book version of Peter Parker would be like on screen. Are there some story liberties taken? Absolutely. But the reason this is the definitive Peter Parker comes down to two things. This Peter Parker holds his own. A lot of people, myself included, have said it kinda sucks that in Homecoming, Tony Stark always comes in and saves Peter. I kinda felt that Far From Home was the journey from being the person who needed to be helped to being your own man and being your own hero. And it looks like I was right because Spider-Man No Way Home sees Peter the most competent he's ever been as Spider-Man. And for those who were worried about Doctor Strange coming in and solving all of Peter's problems, he doesn't. Doctor Strange only exists in this movie as an inciting incident for what is to come. He doesn't come in and save the day. He doesn't take care of everything for Peter. Peter fixes things on his own. If you look at the train scene from the trailer where Peter and Doctor Strange are facing off, it feels good to me that Peter gets out of this situation based on his intellect alone. I also love that in the bridge scene with Doc Ock, Peter doesn't beat Dr. Octopus with sheer muscle. He defeats him with his intellect and his resourcefulness. And that's about as Spider-Man as it gets. Another really great thing to see in this movie that we haven't in this trilogy yet is Spider-Sense being used to its fullest effect. I know that Spider-Sense came up in Infinity War and in Far From Home, and actually one of my favorite parts. But in this movie, the Spider-Sense is a key player to the events that unfold. There's a really great moment between Peter and Doctor Strange that emphasizes what Spider-Sense is, and there's an entire sequence where it goes off that is just absolutely riveting and looks like it was ripped right off of the comic page. But on top of his brain power and all of his abilities, the other defining thing about Peter Parker is that he suffers. He is a tragic hero. The things that happen to Peter in this movie are not just significant because they're happening to Spider-Man and they're bad. They're truly tragic events. And it's not just that Peter suffers, it's that we're watching how he deals with these things. Because the thing that defines Spider-Man is not just tragedy, it's optimism in the face of tragedy. Actually, my two favorite moments in this whole movie both reflect that. I'm gonna get into them, but I'm going to stay vague because I don't want to spoil things. There's a moment in this film where Peter wants to do one thing. Doctor Strange wants to go the complete opposite direction. And at one point, Doctor Strange tells him, "You can't do this. It won't work." And Spider-Man turns to the camera and just goes, "I'm sorry, but I have to try." It works so well for who these characters are, and it shows the arc that Peter has gone on through these three movies to become the Spider-Man that I know. who always wants to help and always wants to do the right thing because he can. There's also a moment towards the end of the movie where Peter finds himself in one of the worst, most depressing situations we've ever seen happen to him. At one point, he's literally faced with a physical manifestation of all of these things coming together. He smiles because he's optimistic and he knows he's going to push through. On top of establishing a really great Spider-Man, this movie also brings back a lot of fan favorite villains. You see Doc Ock, Green Goblin, Electro, Sandman, and the Lizard all show up in this trailer. And it's such an impressive juggling act that they all feel like they have something to do and a reason to be in this movie. Some of the villains do have bigger parts and are more significant antagonists, but even the ones who don't play as big a part in the story still feel like they belong there and actually brought something to what was happening in the movie. Willem Dafoe has not missed a beat playing the Green Goblin. And if we're gonna mention him, we also have to get into Alfred Molina. You would think he had just got done shooting Spider-Man 2 yesterday, and it also didn't corrupt the stories that those characters went through in the Raimi movies. But when we're on the topic of the villains, we also get into my main gripe with this movie, and that's the editing. This feels very minor, but I work in video and film editing, and when I see it not done well, it does bother me, especially for a movie that has this much money. There's a lot of weird editing choices in this movie. You'll see Willem Dafoe or Alfred Molina or even Tom Holland going into these really big, great performance moments, and the camera cuts away to things that are inherently less interesting, especially with Willem Dafoe's Goblin. On top of that, for a movie that focuses so much on reunions and the fantasy of different characters being in the same place at the same time, there's a lot of times that it feels like these actors are not in the same room as each other. That could come down to a couple of things. One could be the worldwide pandemic that this movie was shot during. It may have been difficult to get everybody in the same room, and these shots may be stitched together. Also, this is one of the most leaked movies of all time, so I could see them saying, well, we can't have all of these characters outside, and that's gonna complicate the production schedule as well. It's also worth pointing out that Sandman and Lizard are in this movie, but Thomas Hayden Church and Rhys Ifans are not. And even when you do see them, they're clearly CGI models, not the real actors on set. Why? Because if it's me and I have three major returning villains, maybe that's enough for me if these actors aren't gonna come back. But at the same time, if you did bring back everybody, maybe we would ask, where are those guys? And it's not that I don't like the parts that Lizard and Sandman play in the movie. I actually really enjoyed them both as side characters. As an appreciator of The Amazing Spider-Man and the absolute comic bookness of the Lizard wanting to turn everybody else into a lizard, I love that they brought that back here and how funny it is and how much it works. Because on top of everything else, this is the funniest of the three Spider-Man movies. This movie fires on all cylinders. It has a tight script, in my opinion, and it exceeded expectations in every way possible. And for that reason, when I saw it the first time, it was an A minus, but it's an A plus. The more I think about it, the more things hold together for me, and the happier I am that we saw different things happen that I never thought could be done on screen in a Spider-Man movie. Which of course raises the question, is it the best Spider-Man film? No, I don't think it is. I haven't had a lot of time to sit with it, obviously. It is one of the best Spider-Man films. This is the most comic accurate Spider-Man we've ever seen, and the truest iteration of the character to date on film. But I still think it only ranks second to Spider-Man 2, which works as a movie, I think, a little bit better than this does. For those of you who are curious, here is my definitive Spider-Man film ranking. And I do think I will eventually make a video about this that is not a podcast episode. All in all, as a Spider-Man fan, I feel like this movie systematically went through and fixed every issue that I've had with this Spider-Man over the years, and still made a really great film while doing it. That's something that I'll be able to watch again and again. And I can't say how happy I am to have seen a movie like this. Real quick before the video ends, let's jump into some spoilers. This movie's got a lot of surprise cameos in it. I think everybody knew that going in. But one of the biggest surprise ones was Charlie Cox showing up at the beginning. I think this is such a great idea. We said right from Spider-Man No Way Home that Daredevil should show up in the next movie to defend Spider-Man, even if it's in a small role. But I said during that whole time, I think it'll be a different Daredevil. And I'm so happy to say that I was wrong. The Daredevil TV show is one of my favorite superhero things that has ever happened, and Daredevil is my second favorite Marvel character. I think Charlie Cox brings a great dimension to this character, and I'm so excited just to know that he and Spider-Man have met each other. They know each other. But of course, Charlie Cox is just a tease for what is to come. I don't think there's anybody out there who didn't know Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire were going to be in this movie. But man, was it so nice to see them. I've been worried since I heard they were going to be in it that their involvement would be a little cheesy, a little fan servicey, and not fit into the story. And I'm happy to say that only one of those things is true. It's fan service, 100%, but fan service doesn't always mean that something's bad. Tobey Maguire and especially Andrew Garfield have very legitimate places in this story. I love that their inclusion here allows them to get a send-off that we never got for either character. This movie functions so well as a beautiful swan song for both Tobey Maguire and especially Andrew Garfield, who now gets a chance to be Spider-Man, a performance that I've always loved, in a movie that works on all levels rather than the enjoyable but flawed Amazing Spider-Man movies. Folks, if you can't tell, I absolutely loved Spider-Man No Way Home, and I love all things Spider-Man. The characters brought me a ton of joy, and this movie just continues that. I love Spider-Man.